Hi, and welcome to my talk. Today we are going to be discussing like weird things, the story of a python, a snake, and a vulture. Okay, so vulture is a scavenger, by the way, so it eats dead stuff, and that pun is the inspiration for us. So I'll start off with a little introduction. My name is Rahul Jha, and I'm better known on the internet as RJ722. And I'm still an engineering student. I'm in my final year right now. I study electronics engineering. I am an open source Pythonista, which is a fancy way of saying I code in Python and I put it in the open source domain. And even more than the open source projects, I like the idea of the communities surrounding them. And I'm quite lucky to be a part of a few of them. And the most prominent being the DGPLUG, Durgapur Linux User Group, and the one I have at my college, AMUOSS, Aligarh Muslim University's Open Source Software Society. Okay, that's been my boring introduction. I write my blog at rj722.github.io, and rj722 on Twitter was already occupied, so I have like Rahul722J. Okay, that's it. Now, for the next 20 minutes or so, we are going to be discussing dead code a lot. A lot of it. So it's like worth spending the time on. Let's define this term, dead code. What does it exactly mean when we say the term dead code? It's a little opinionated, but what I have made sense out of it is that dead code is any part of your source program which does not affect the usability of your application, which means it's just redundant. If you remove it, I mean, it won't really change the application or any part of your application flow. It won't change the behavior, so it's just redundant. Let me show you some examples, and that will probably make things more clearer. So here, this is like a really complex program I wrote, print hello world. But what you see is like import TensorFlow STF, the first line. It will take around like 1 or 2 seconds, which is another thing which is to take care of when you have unused imports. It will take up some sort of runtime, and that is not a good thing. One of the ways like why you should remove dead code from your projects. So unused imports are like the most prominent and the most I have found this dead code to in most projects. And there are other kinds of dead code too. So like if you define some variables but you never actually end up using them, so that's one, that's another example of dead code. There is, I have seen like code after return statements in Python, it will never ever be executed. And third one is like, it's a little special, I'll be talking about it in a few moments. It's unsatisfiable Boolean conditions. So when you have like conditions if true, and then there's an else block also, it won't ever get executed. There's a special thing about it, I'll discuss. And I know what you might be thinking right now. This seems legit, but I'm not stupid. Why would I write this code? So this isn't actually stupid. It's much more like, it's a human way of expressing. We have these kinds of, when we're developing something, it's not that we just come up with the final product. We document our journey, we try different things, they fail, and then finally, there was an XKCD, if you have to go from point A to point B, the linear distance between them, it seems like the most sensible way of doing it, but it isn't generally the way we go. We go round and round and round until we finally reach place B somehow. And in this journey, we might like leave around traces of what was there initially. And that is like one of the reasons. So I talked about the unsatisfiable Boolean conditions. Yesterday night, I had this crazy idea that I would run Vulture, we'll be talking about it, on C Python's code. I found like a couple examples of dead code, and there was a special example, this. So this code right here says, if one, then do this, else do this. And this code has been written by, any guesses? Okay, this code was committed 20 years ago by the creator of Python. And I'm still not sure why. I can't make heads and tails out of this code. And I'm not sure that this exactly is dead code here. I discussed this with a friend of mine who is like crazy smart being maintainer of PipSmart. And he also was confused. Like, he said maybe this is dead code, but maybe not. So I'm still not sure. But yeah, this was like a unique thing because this was the first time I actually found the unreachable else block. And now you might be wondering, what are all the other ways the dead code might crawl into your project? Here. So there are like a couple of ways where the most prominent being debugging. When you're debugging software, you need to really read between the lines. And for that, you need to define some extra variables. Maybe you have a function where you would pretty print something. And then whenever the tests start passing, if you're even remotely like me, it would be like git commit dash am done. And that's it. There, ladies and gentlemen, you introduce dead code into your program. Another one is refactoring. Again, the same as debugging. You tweak some things, you optimize your code, maybe you do something else, and then you leave around the traces of the old code, and again, ends up being dead. There are also some spelling mistakes, which are like which might lead to dead code. So now, OK, cool. There's dead code. There's a lot of it. There's an example of it in the CPython repository. Why do I care? Because it's not cool. See, first of all, there might be even bugs which may be introduced because of dead code. The unused function you might have might even be like superseding a function you might actually want to use with the same name. So that is a weird way of like introducing bugs into your system. And the second thing is like the maintenance burden. When you write code, you have to maintain it for the next 20 years. See, the maintenance burden is a direct proportional function of the code size. So if you can somehow reduce the code size, you are reducing the maintenance burden on you. And that is like a pretty important thing. Maybe you have a beginner coming in and reading onto your code after yourself, and you might be, and they might end up wondering, okay, what is this thing doing over here? I mean, I can't figure out what it does. And they might be afraid, they might be confused. So that's this. So is there a way out? Yes, my lord, there is. It's called Vulture. So the pun is that Vulture scavenges on dead code. OK, let's go for a demo. I was taught that like whatever you do in a talk, don't ever do a demo. And that's precisely what I chose to do. So everything will go smoothly, Murphy's Law. OK, so the slides aren't changing. Alt FN F11. See, everything's going smoothly. Okay. Yeah. So, let's first install Vulture. It's as easy as doing pip install Vulture. That's it. I already installed it because there might have been connection issues here. So that's it, basically. And then what you do is like you write Vulture. I have a file over here. Let's first look what does the file looks like. Yeah. So what it does is there's a person called Guido. And then there's a function I want. Like I want to greet someone. So I say hello, the person's name, which is the argument to the function. And when I was writing the actual code, as is often the case, I forgot that I have a function for this, and I ended up doing it myself right in here. So this function here is unused. Let's try running Vulture on it and see. Vulture basic, one basic demo.py. Huh. You get one basic demo.py, which is the file name, and this is the line number. Okay, you have on line number 3, there's an unused function called greet. Okay, good. We found it good. But there's also this thing, this 60% confidence. So what this shows is like how sure Vulture is that your code is actually unused and it's not a false positive. So you might be wondering, okay, so Vulture gives false positives too? Yeah, it does, and we'll talk about it just in a second. And before this, like I want to show you that all Python projects mostly end up having some sort of dead code. And to prove my point, what I did was like I went on to GitHub trending section, and I selected the language Python, and I just cloned the first project that came up. It was Detectron 2. I have it cloned up right here. See, Detectron 2, and I will try running Vulture on it right here. It will take a second. Yeah. So even this code has so much of dead code. See? So that was my point. Now, we are back to this thing, 60% confidence. Okay, so let's study what all are the cases when Vulture would actually like report dead code. So I have this file over here. Let me see if I can, yeah. So this is just a basic Flask app, a minimal Flask app, which what it does is like whenever it receives a request on slash, it will return a string hello world, simple. So if I, let's try running Vulture on this thing, Vulture to underscore Flask example. Huh? Index function is being reported as unused here. Any guesses why? Okay, it has to do something with like how Vulture like finds the what part of your code is unused. We'll talk about this. Let's also try one other example. There's also 3_dynamic_code.py. So what I have here is like I have a class, mock class, which has a method do something, and I created an instance of the mock class here. And rather than doing mock dot do something, what I do is like I create a dynamic object, I pass in the instance, and then I search for this name in the method list of the class mock, and I find this, and then I call this thing here. So what it does is, let's try running it, Python 3_, and yeah, I did something, so it is working. Let's try running Vulture on this. Again, unused. So let's try, let's see, okay, why is this being reported as unused? So what Vulture does is whenever it sees, you say that identifying dead code from this project, what it does is it parses something, it parses your code into something known as an AST, an abstract syntax tree. So what is an abstract syntax tree? So abstract syntax tree, I'll discuss the three words and maybe you can make more sense out of it. So an abstract syntax tree. Abstract here means that you are not gonna like represent the code as is you have already typed, not the aesthetics. We are not concerned about whatever white spaces you might have in the say you whether used single quotes or double quotes in the code. You're only concerned with the pure representation it is independent of the form factor. The syntax here means that it is syntactically correct, means it is following all the grammar rules of Python, and T is stands for tree here, which is like a very popular data structure. So let's try parsing this expression over here into an AST. So this is a mathematical this is mathematical expression 10^2 + 5, that gives 25. Okay, so what we have is like the most basic node 10, 2, they get multiplied, this gives me 20, and we have got 5 here, so this is 25. Easy, right? Okay, let's try something more complex. I'll show you an AST here, and let's see if we can figure out what code does it represents in Python. Okay, so we have an if node over here. This is how the Python grammar would represent any if node in the language. So first thing is there's a compare thing. Which what it does is it evaluates whether or not the condition you have passed is true or not. So here it is a greater than symbol, and the variable number, there's a variable called number, and it is compared with an integer called 5. And if it is greater than that, it will go into the true node. What it does is then it returns a string called bigger than 5, and if it is false, it returns not bigger than 5. Okay, so the code for it would look something like this. Number greater than 5, return this, else this. Okay, so all the beautiful drawings here, they are by Toby Osborne, and here's the link. He explains abstract syntax trees pretty clearly. Make sure to check it out. Okay, let's try one more thing. Let's try looking into how the AST node for this function would look like. Okay, so we have a function greet, which does basically print hello, the person's name. Yeah, so there's this node function def, which tells Python, okay, the node you are trying to access is a function definition, and the name of it is greet, and the arguments you have is only one argument in this case, which is the greet name, which is the name of the person you're trying to greet. And the third thing is a link to, okay, what does this function do? What is the call, like when you call the function, what is ought to do? Here it is just a print statement, hello plus the person's name. Okay, let's try for one more thing. This is a module, a basic module which we just saw in the example. So let's see, okay, what does an AST for this looks like? First of all, I'm sorry for my horrible handwriting. I didn't have the time to like make the fancy slides, so I just drew it myself. What I want to do here is like I want to emulate what Vulture does in the form of a diagram. So let's try doing it live. Okay. So what Vulture does is initially when it sees an AST, is it initializes two buckets. Okay, I have two buckets over here. One is known as defined bucket, and other one is the used bucket. Okay, so the names are self-explanatory. So whenever the Vulture parses it as an AST, what it does is it starts parsing nodes one by one. So first it would go here. It sees, okay, this is an assigned node. It means that a value is being assigned to a variable. So we see that the string Guido is being assigned to a variable called person. So it will just put, Vulture has been programmed to put this name person into this thing, defined. Okay, so we'll put person over here. That's good. Now it comes on to the second node, the function definition node. Now Vulture has been programmed, whenever it encounters a function definition node, what it will do is, it will just go on to the name, greet, and then it will put this into the defined list. So we'll have another thing in the list, greet. I'm sorry for my writing. And the third thing is, it will jump on to the third node, if node, and it will check for both the true and the false thing. So it will check for true, and it says print, okay. Oh yeah, person thing is being referenced over here. So it puts that, okay, this thing is being used, so I might as well put it in a bucket, person. Okay, so now we have two buckets, one defined, one used. And this is how we can like extract the unused code out of it. We got defined thing, person, and greet. And we saw that, okay, this thing is using the used thing, person. So the unused part is just the greet. And we also store the metadata about every node. That is how we can store, like, this is an unused function, and it is on line number 3, the length. And okay. So what about our problem? Our problem was that the dynamic code, which isn't explicitly mentioned in the AST, what is the time whenever you are using getEtter or setEtter, we can't actually just directly parse it from the AST what type of node you are being using, and that is why Vulture reports it as unused. So now you might be thinking, okay, so my build will fail every time I have one of these necessary conditions, or if I'm using a Flask project, it will always fail. Vulture. So no, we have a solution, and the solution looks like this. If I use my unused code, it's no longer unused. Okay. So what it does is, it basically, we try to fool Vulture. What we say is, we create a different file, a new file, and we just write the names of the things which we know are being used, but the Vulture is reporting as unused. So what it does is it just references that name, and then this name can be there in the AST, and then it can be parsed and put into the used bucket, and thereby it won't be reported as unused. So so there can be a file. In this case, you can create a whitelist.py file, and you can just write a single line over there, greet. I'll show you. Right here, I keep, okay. Okay, for the Flask example, we have this index thing. Okay, let's create a Flask whitelist.py index. That's all. That's all we have to do. And now Vulture 2_Flask example Flask whitelist.py. And yay, it didn't report it as unused. Now I was doing it a lot manually. So what I did in fact was, like, there is a way we can automate this thing. So you can pass a flag called --- make whitelist, and it will print it in a format which you can directly copy and paste into a file, or you can pipe it directly into a file. And you won't be needing, so like once you've ensured that all the output by Vulture is being, what is being reported is actually being used, so you can just pipe it into a file, let's say whitelist.py, and you're done. And then whenever you will be running Vulture on your project, you can just include that file name. Okay, so my expectation is that I've made you people realize that Vulture is awesome. And you might be wondering, okay, this is real cool stuff. I want to help out. What is the way? So it's good news. We are totally open source. It's an MIT licensed project on GitHub. It was made by a very smart person who is also my mentor, Jendrik Seip. He has a PhD at University of Basel, Switzerland. And we're also hosting dev sprints in PyCon India on 14th and 15th October in IITM Research Park. Come collaborate with us. We'll hack on some real issues. We have like when the upgrade in Python 3.8, this has some new sort of new AST nodes defined, and we need to like update Vulture's code for handling those nodes, and it would be fun. Come. At last, I also want to give credits to all the people who helped me throughout this presentation. Hussein, Pradyun, Prajwal, Pratik, and Satvik. Thank you. And that's all, folks. Thank you so much. Also, one more thing, the slides link here, it will give you a 404 for now. I'll just go and upload the slides. Okay.
So, we have time for only one question. Here, gone, sorry.
Isn't Pylint going to tell you that these imports are unused?
Yeah.
I mean, how different is Vulture?
There is no difference other than like Vulture also detects these things called like the special thing I told, unreachable code in terms of after return statements, unused functions, the PyLinter, I think it Flaket also does this, but it only is limited to unused imports and variables. We also do it with functions, the methods, and we have some pretty fascinating, like you can watch the GitHub repository and you can see that we have some pretty sophisticated configuration you can pass on. So if you're using, if you have test cases which are only run by the unit test, it would be reported as unused by every other tool. But we have some ways, some mechanism so that we can just whitelist all that code at once without any configuration whatsoever. So like that's the other thing.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.